Hello everyone, thank you so much for being here. This is a training designed for homeowners in Puerto Rico who are receiving a solar PV and battery system as part of the Community Energy and Water Resilience Installations Program, known as CEWRI. My name is Allison Moe, and I will be delivering this presentation along with my colleague Donald Jenkett. Donald and I both work at the National Renewable Energy Laboratory, or NREL, in Golden, Colorado. The goal of the CEWRI program is to promote resilience by providing homeowners with solar photovoltaic, or PV, systems with battery backup to cover critical energy needs in their homes. As you all know, the 2017 hurricanes left the majority of Puerto Rico residents without power for extended periods of time, weakening what was already a strained energy system. This program that you are part of and that we are discussing today is just one piece in a very large and ambitious recovery program for the island, with support from many public and private partners. Historic amounts of disaster relief funds were brought in, and this program is working to ensure that the benefits of that funding go to support those hardest hit by high utility bill rates and extended power outages. This training is designed to help you know what to expect from your solar PV and battery backup system. Some of you will also be receiving water cisterns through this program. However, this specific training is focused on the solar PV and battery backup systems only. This is an outline of everything that we will cover today. I will start by describing the benefits of solar PV and battery systems generally. I will then provide an overview of the CEWRI program, including the responsibilities of the various people and groups involved, followed by an introduction to solar PV and battery system technology and what to expect during the installation process. My colleague Don Jenkett will then talk about what it will look like to operate and maintain your system once it is installed and functioning, and what to do in the event of a future storm. In this first section, I will describe the benefits of having a solar PV and battery system on your home. Upon completion of this section, you should be able to understand the purpose of a PV and battery system, describe the economic, resilience, and environmental benefits of a PV and battery system, understand the basics of net metering and what the savings on your energy bill may look like. And finally, you should be able to implement energy efficiency and conservation best practices in order to get the most out of your PV and battery system. I want to start with a big picture. What is a solar photovoltaic, or PV, system? Simply put, PV systems convert sunlight into electricity that you can use in your home. The electricity can be used immediately as it is created, or it can be stored in batteries at the same location for future use, for example, at night. Solar PV has the potential to benefit Puerto Rico in many ways. We will talk about three main types of benefits here. Economic benefits, which impact you directly in the form of savings on your utility bills. Resiliency benefits, which impact you and your communities in preparing for future storm events. And environmental benefits, which impact the health of the island and all of its residents more generally. The most direct benefit that you will experience from this program comes in the form of savings on your utility bills. As some background, the Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority, or PREPA, currently imports fossil fuels to the island, which are burned in plants to generate electricity and then sent through cables and wires across the island and into your home. Your monthly electricity bill pays for all of that. With solar PV on your home, when the sun is out, you are creating most, if not all, of your own electricity so that you no longer need to buy it all from your utility. And we will go through the details of how that all works a little bit later. So the solar PV that you will receive through this program will cost you no money up front. It will generate electricity that you can use directly in your home so that you buy less from the utility. And ultimately, this will save you money on your utility bills. I do want to point out that solar PV powers appliances that use electricity, such as lights and refrigerators, and does not affect your liquid propane, gas, or LPG bill, or any appliances that might use LPG, such as your stove or your oven. Now, while participating in this program, you will probably hear the terms interconnection and net metering, and I want to talk a little bit about what those are as they are related to your bill. An interconnection agreement is essentially a contract with your utility for installing your solar PV and battery system at your home and connecting it to the electrical grid. Net metering is part of the interconnection agreement, and it allows you to receive credit on your utility bill when your solar PV system generates more electricity than you use in your home or store in your batteries, sending that extra electricity back out to the grid to be used by other homes and buildings nearby. If you receive a net metering credit, that can lower your monthly electricity bill even beyond what you will save just having your own solar PV system. It may take a little while after your system is installed before this agreement is processed, but once in place, you will start to see a credit on your monthly bill for whatever amount of your solar electricity you don't use or store. I do want to note that not every home in the CEWRI program will have this in place, so you will want to talk about this with your installer so that you know what to expect. The CEWRI program will provide you with a standard-sized solar PV and battery system to power critical loads only. Critical loads are defined as essential household appliances, like your refrigerator, some lighting fixtures, and medical or other devices. The specific items included as critical loads will vary by household, and you can talk to your installer more about that. Let me reiterate that critical loads do not include everything in your home. For example, it may not include air conditioning if you have it, and it won't include items that run on liquid propane gas. Your PV system will produce an expected range of electricity each day based on the size of your system and the weather conditions day to day. It will not generate unlimited electricity, and the amount of electricity that it generates will decrease slightly over time as different components in your system age. For this reason, I want to talk now about energy efficiency and energy conservation measures, which can increase the impact of your solar PV and battery system over its lifetime, which we call 25 years or more, and this can really maximize the economic benefits to you. First, I will talk about energy efficiency. Energy efficiency is about using technologies that require less energy or electricity to perform the same function. You see some examples here in blue, and light bulbs are a really good example to illustrate this concept. You see on the image to the right the three main types of light bulbs that you can use. These are incandescent, the least energy efficient, fluorescent, or CFL, and LED, which are the most efficient. In the example shown here on the right side of the screen, say you have a lamp that you use in your home and you keep it for 25 years. In that time, it might use 25 incandescent light bulbs, the least efficient type of bulb. That may cost you $190 total over those 25 years, including both the cost to buy the bulbs and the cost of electricity that the bulbs use. CFL bulbs last much longer than incandescents and use less electricity to put out the same amount of light. So for the same lamp over 25 years, you might only need to buy 2 or 3 CFL bulbs instead of 25 incandescent bulbs, costing a total of $47 instead of $190. And finally, if you use LED bulbs, which are the most energy efficient, you might only need 1 bulb to produce that same amount of light over that 25 years at a total cost of only $37. Now, please remember that when you're replacing your light bulbs and you're at the store, an incandescent is going to be much, much less expensive to buy up front compared to an LED light bulb. It can seem counterintuitive to spend that extra money up front, but we want you to understand that it really will save you much more in the long run. Now, this savings in this example on light bulbs may not seem like a lot, but when you apply the same idea to larger appliances that cost more and use more electricity, it really does start to add up. For example, products that have an Energy Star label can use as much as 90% less electricity than older models. They also produce less heat. Heat in this case refers to wasted energy from the inefficiency of an appliance, and which unfortunately can heat up your home even when you don't want it. So this slide gives an example of what I was just describing for refrigerators, which is a standard home appliance that typically uses the most electricity because it is large and running all the time. If your refrigerator is 30 or 40 years old, it is not going to be very energy efficient, and it might cost you $400 per year to operate. A refrigerator that is half that age, 20 or 25 years old, would cost half that to operate, more like $200 per year. And a brand new Energy Star model would cost less than half of that, something like $88 per year to operate. And this is all because the newer models are more energy efficient, using less electricity to do the same thing as your old ones. Same as the light bulb example on the last slide, but this has a bigger economic impact to you. So that was energy efficiency. Energy conservation, on the other hand, is about changing your behaviors in order to use less energy versus getting a more efficient appliance. The easiest way to do this is to simply turn off equipment when you are not using it, things like lights or televisions or computers. You can use advanced power strips to help with this. You can also unplug charging devices, like your cell phone charger, once they are fully charged. So how do you know what to unplug? Any device that is warm to the touch, like a charger, or has a small indicator light, like a television or a microwave, is using electricity even when you are not actively using that appliance, and that's a good one to unplug. That little bit of electricity I was just talking about is known as a phantom load, something which draws power even when the device is turned off or not being used, but is still plugged in. This slide gives you some examples of just how much a phantom load might be in terms of watts, which is a unit for measuring the amount of energy used. Don't worry too much about how much a watt is, worry about it in comparison to other things. For example, a television could use up to 6 watts of energy at any given moment, even when it isn't turned on. When you think back to a few slides ago when we talked about light bulbs, an efficient LED light bulb uses 9 watts of electricity when it is turned on only. As you can see in the table here, a cable TV box uses that same amount as that LED light bulb even when it is turned off, and that's 24 hours a day. So these things can really add up. Energy conservation is not just about turning things off or unplugging them. It can also look like maximizing the natural sunlight in your home to reduce lighting needs, taking advantage of window ventilation to moderate temperatures, painting the exterior of your home a lighter color to reflect light and heat, or using ceiling fans and window shades to regulate the indoor temperature of your home. If you have an air conditioner or use electric fans in your home, these items use a lot of electricity, and these types of energy conservation measures can make a bigger impact. In this way, energy conservation can enhance your on-site PV system and help you meet your home's critical loads even during power outages. So that was a lot of information about the economic benefits of your solar PV and battery system. But there are other types of benefits, such as resilience. Resilience is the ability of a person, a structure, or a community to recover or bounce back from a harmful or catastrophic event. For the purposes of this training, we are talking about how quickly the electricity can be restored to your home after a storm, and we are comparing having a PV and battery system at your home versus relying on Puerto Rico's power grid to get back up and running. As you all know, Puerto Rico's current power system is aging. It has been damaged by recent storms. It's reliant on imported fossil fuels, which can be expensive. It's vulnerable to weather events, and it's centralized, meaning that if one power plant or one stretch of power lines goes down, many people are affected. Solar PV and battery systems that are distributed on individual rooftops increase resilience by allowing structures or homes to generate, store, and use electricity even if the power grid is down. The CEWRI program is doing this for you in your home, but you may or may not have heard that in 2019, the Puerto Rico Energy Public Policy Act established a goal for the Commonwealth to generate 100% of its energy from renewable resources by 2050, expanding this benefit to the whole island. As part of the CEWRI program, you are one of the early pioneers to help Puerto Rico reach its renewable energy goals. So what does this discussion of resiliency mean for you and your home with solar PV? During normal operations, your PV system will generate enough electricity to power most, if not all, electrical appliances and devices during the day when sunlight is available. Your battery storage system will store a set amount of electricity that you can use at night to power critical loads and reduce your utility bills. During a power outage, storm, or other event that affects utility power, your PV system will have a shutoff switch that disconnects your system from the power grid, if your system is in fact tied to the grid. Your system will provide direct power to your home and charge the battery storage system during the day, and this will allow you to run critical loads. Again, these are some household appliances, lights, and life support devices when power from the utility is not available. This will help you to safely shelter in place. And really, this is at the heart of the CEWRI program. We want families that are most at risk and struggle the most during storm events to be able to stay as safe and healthy as possible. This benefit goes beyond the economic benefits of saving you money that we discussed earlier. And finally, the broadest and maybe the least tangible benefit of solar PV systems are the environmental benefits. As I've mentioned before, Puerto Rico currently relies on imported fossil fuels to generate the majority of its electricity. The outdated fossil fuel plants on the island can impact air quality and the health of nearby communities. For you, this might look like higher rates of asthma or other lung and heart conditions, or issues around clean water. Greenhouse gas emissions, or GHG, are one measure of that type of impact on air quality. In general, the GHG from generating solar PV energy, that is from manufacturing the equipment through the 25 years of operation and the disposal, are minimal when compared to the traditional forms of fossil fuel generation. According to research done by NREL, coal-fired electricity releases about 20 times more greenhouse gas emissions per unit of energy than solar PV. For context, the amount of carbon emissions reduction that you could expect each year from installing a 3-kilowatt solar PV system, which is about the size you will likely receive through the CEWRI program, is similar in its environmental impact to taking a car off the road for 8 months. Reducing emissions is therefore beneficial to the economy, to the environment, and to human health. This is the last slide in this section, and it's probably the most technical slide that we have today. It's illustrating the difference between a centralized power generation system, which Puerto Rico currently has, and a smart distributed system that it is trying to develop. On the left, you see the existing system, which looks pretty straightforward. Power is generated at a plant and distributed to buildings and homes through power transmission lines. The image to the right may look much more complicated, but really, this is about increasing the variety and location of power generation so that the whole system isn't shut down if one part of it is damaged. You can see on the image to the right that in the future, the island will generate electricity from a mix of fossil fuels, wind, solar, geothermal, and other sources hopefully reaching that 100% renewable goal that I mentioned previously. Some of these power generation sources will still rely on transmission lines to move that electricity around the island, but some of it can be generated right where it's used, such as the solar PV system that you will be receiving on your home through this program. In the future, the new power grid will also be able to start interacting with smarter and more efficient devices within homes and buildings, which again can make the whole system more efficient and less susceptible to storms and other disruptions. That first section focused on why solar PV could be beneficial to you and your community. The second section dives into the details of the CEWRI program and what to expect from it. Upon completion of this section, you should be able to identify contractor and installer responsibilities and required certifications, understand what to expect during your installation process, and be familiar with the basic requirements for your PV and battery system. As you can see on this slide, there are a lot of people involved in making the CEWRI program a success, so you will likely be interacting most with the people to the right side of the screen. On the far left is the Puerto Rico Department of Housing, who administers the CEWRI program and the funding for it, which in turn comes from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, or HUD. Next is the Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority, or PREPA, which is now split into two functions, with transmission and distribution being run by LUMA. This is who provides your home with power now, and they are the agency with whom you may end up having an interconnection agreement, which we discussed earlier. Next, you see the program manager, who oversees the overall implementation of the CEWRI program. And they communicate between all parties, which is why they are shown here at the center. You may interact with them early on to qualify for the program, and you may see them occasionally on site. Contractors or installers are the people that you will interact with the most in this program. They are responsible for assessing your home for suitability for solar PV, designing and installing the system, providing training to you about your system, and providing system warranties. We will talk more about their specific responsibilities on the following slides. The final stakeholder shown here all the way on the right side of the screen is you, the homeowner. Once the system is installed on your home, you will own that system and you will be responsible for performing some routine maintenance to keep the system running and to watch for issues. We will talk in this section about installer responsibilities, and your responsibilities as the homeowner will be covered in a later section. Installers are responsible for assessing your home to make sure the solar PV can work there, designing the solar PV and battery system, obtaining any permits that are required, and purchasing all materials. Then, they will actually install the PV and battery system on your home according to local codes. They will test the system to make sure it functions properly, and they will connect your system with the utility. Once the system is complete, the installer will also provide a warranty for your PV and battery system and its components, which again, we will discuss in more detail in a later section. The installers will provide on-site training for you with details specific to your system in your home, and they will provide you with an owner's manual to cover some of this information. We at NREL have also developed a training for installers to make sure that they understand their responsibilities to you in this program. But be sure to discuss any home renovations or other changes you may have planned with the installer. Ask any questions you might have so that you understand your system and can help it function successfully. Finally, you can expect the actual installation of your solar PV and battery system to take about 1 week. The overall process, though, from site assessment to final inspection and interconnection, may take 1 to 2 months or more. The CEWRI program has put in place several requirements for installers, requirements which are intended to keep you safe. First, Your installer is required to be certified under the Public Energy Policy Program of the Puerto Rico Department of Economic Development and Trade. They must install the solar PV and battery system in compliance with all Puerto Rico Residential Code, National Electric Code, Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority, and Permit Management Office regulations. And finally, the system will be inspected to make sure that it was built in compliance with all of these items. In addition to the requirements I just described, all solar PV and battery systems installed through the CEWRI program will use materials rated for use in Puerto Rico's climate. They will have industry standard warranties on all the equipment. The panels will be tilted 5 to 10 degrees to the south, and the system will not void your roof warranty. Your installer is actually required to give you documentation that you can share with your home insurance, verifying that the PV system will not void your roof warranty. Again, all of these requirements are designed to ensure that you receive a quality system that will provide you with all the benefits we discussed in the last section and help keep you and your home safe. Finally, I've said before that you will receive a standard-sized PV and battery system, and there are two basic ways that this will be determined. The first scenario is for homes with a refrigerator that consumes 489 kilowatt hours per year or less of energy, which is essentially a new energy efficient refrigerator. The second scenario is for homes with older refrigerators that use more electricity. As we mentioned in the previous section, refrigerators tend to be one of the highest energy consuming appliances in a home, and older appliances require a larger solar PV system to cover the critical loads of the home. This is important to remember because in the future, if you buy a new refrigerator or other appliances or replace the ones that you have, remember that your PV system size is fixed. So far, we have discussed solar PV systems generally. In this section, I will give you a short introductory lesson on how a solar PV and battery backup system actually function. Upon completion of this section, you should be able to identify the major components of your PV and battery system and understand what each component does. As I mentioned at the beginning of this training, solar PV systems convert sunlight into electricity that you can use in your home. That electricity can be generated, used, and stored all in the same location. The image you see in this slide shows the major components of a PV and battery system and how they work together in your home. We will be discussing all of these items in more detail on the following slides. For now, though, I want to give you an overall sense of how that system works. The red line that you see in the image shows the flow of electricity through all the different parts of your system. Please note that this is a conceptual graphic, and we know that your home and your PV system will not look just like this. In general, the PV panels, known as a PV array, generate a set amount of electricity when sunlight is available. This electricity directly powers appliances in the home that are running. These are known as the loads. Any surplus electricity that is generated but not used immediately is sent into batteries to be stored. And if the batteries are fully charged, that electricity is sent back to the utility through the distribution power lines to be used in neighboring buildings. When sunlight is not available at night, you can use power from the utility or the power stored in your batteries. When power from the utility is not available, such as during a storm or after a storm, these batteries store enough electricity to run the critical loads in your home, which again are some household appliances like lights and refrigerators, as well as life support devices. Now I will go into a little bit more detail on each individual element of your PV and battery system. First and most importantly is the solar photovoltaic or PV panels, which are technically called modules. This is what most people typically think of when they think about solar PV electricity. Each solar module is made up of individual solar cells, which you can see in the top right image of this slide being held in someone's hand. These small cells capture and transmit the electrons from sunlight. The individual cells are connected in chains to form modules or solar panels. Multiple modules are then connected together to form arrays, and the array connects to the other system components that we will discuss next to power the appliances in your home. We will talk later in this training about how to maintain your system, but I do want to say right now that it's very important to keep your PV array clear from shade or debris as much as possible. This is because the power generated by each individual solar panel or module in the array is reduced to the level of the lowest performing module that it is connected to. So if one individual module on your home is shaded by half, then the electricity generated by all of the modules that it is connected to will also decrease by half, even if those other modules are in full sun. Finally, I want to talk about safety, and you are going to hear this a lot in the upcoming slides. PV arrays generate electricity and can cause severe injury or even death. Only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment. After solar modules, the next largest component of a solar PV system is the batteries. Batteries store the electricity generated by the modules for future use, for example, at nighttime, during cloudy days, or on days with high electricity use, and during a power outage. The batteries do not generate electricity. They simply store it and shift the time when you can use the electricity generated by your solar PV system. Your installer will provide you with more detail and specifications for your battery system. And again, batteries store electricity and may contain hazardous materials requiring other safety considerations. Only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment, including the batteries. The next major component of your system is the racking, which is the structural system that supports the modules and safely connects them to the roof surface or the ground, depending on how your system is installed. Again, your roof probably doesn't look like the one in this photo, but the racking structure should look similar. Your installer will provide you with more detail about the racking for your specific solar PV system. Next is the inverter. This is an incredibly important component, and we haven't talked about it yet. The inverter is what converts the electricity generated by the sun through the modules into the type of electricity that we use in our homes. For a variety of reasons that we won't cover in this training, most homes and buildings in the world use alternating current, or AC, electricity. But the electricity that comes from the sun is direct current, or DC, electricity. DC is also the type of current used in batteries. Inverters convert that DC electricity from the modules to the AC for your home. Your installer will provide you with more detail and specifications about your inverter. And once again, inverters convert electricity and therefore can be dangerous. Only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment. Finally, I'm going to talk about wiring. Cables and wires connect solar modules together and provide a path for electricity to flow from the modules to your home's electrical system and/or back out onto the utility grid. Modules typically have built-in cables that connect to other modules and/or to the inverter, and you can see those cables being connected in the photo shown here. Cables are rated for weather exposure, but they should be securely attached under the modules and off of the roof surface to keep them protected. Animals can chew on wires, wind can rub them along the surface of your roof and start to wear out that protective plastic coating around the wires. So it's important to protect any exposed wiring that connects the PV array to other system components with a conduit. Conduit is a metal or plastic tube that acts as a tunnel for the wiring and protect it. Your installer will provide details and specifications for your wiring system. Once again, electrical wires can be very dangerous, especially if they are damaged or exposed. Only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment, including the wiring. The last thing I will say is that if you are attending this training, your home has likely already been selected to receive a solar PV and battery system. But understanding what makes a home good for solar PV in general will help you to understand and better maintain your system. The first thing is roof quality. Despite the photo used on this slide, only homes with concrete roofs are eligible for the CEWRI program. Your home must have enough roof space to fit your PV system, and the roof must be strong enough to support the system's weight. Finally, the roof must be in good shape, meaning that it doesn't need to be replaced soon. I do want to note here that if future repairs are required on your roof, it is recommended to hire a licensed contractor to remove and reinstall the solar PV in its systems. This is not covered under your system warranty, but it will help ensure that any repairs done to your roof do not invalidate the warranties on your solar PV system. The second thing that makes a home good for solar is having adequate sunlight. As you now understand, solar PV systems only generate electricity when the sun is up and shining on the modules. The modules being installed on your home should be tilted or angled 5 to 10 degrees to the south in order to collect the maximum amount of solar energy over the course of a day and throughout the year. We want minimal trees or buildings nearby to shade the array. As I discussed previously, even if one module out of all of the ones on your roof is shaded, it can decrease the output of the entire system. Finally, the electrical system in your home must also be adequate. This means that the service panel has room to safely add the PV system. Thank you all. I will now hand this training over to my colleague, Donald Jenkett.
In the next section, I'll describe the operation and maintenance of your PV and battery system. Upon completion of this section, you should be able to describe the responsibilities of you, the homeowner, understand how to operate the PV and battery system at a basic level, practice the basics of system maintenance, and become familiar with system monitoring basics and how to know if something is wrong. As discussed previously, there are many people involved with making this program a success. This section will focus on your responsibilities to help ensure your PV and battery system remains safe and operates as intended. It is important to note that this section is intended as a general overview. Like the previous sections, the slides in this section will show conceptual images. Your system components or installed system may look differently, and it is important to work with your installer to understand what each component is and how to safely monitor and operate your PV and battery system. On this slide is a list of the responsibilities for you, the homeowner. Your first two responsibilities have already been covered in previous sections. First, understanding the basics of your PV and battery system, which was discussed in section 3, and second, practicing energy efficiency and conservation principles, which was discussed in section 1. As a quick recap, your PV and battery system is designed to power your critical loads, not necessarily everything you use. This is why it is important to practice energy efficiency and conservation principles not only daily, but especially during and after a storm or other catastrophic event causing a grid outage. This includes unplugging phantom loads. This will help ensure that your PV and battery system can continue to power your critical loads. Your next responsibility is to cooperate with and provide access for the program manager and installers. You have likely already had to do this during the assessment process, but the workers will need access to your roof and home electrical systems until the installation is complete. Coordinate with your installers to understand where they need access and the best way to reach these areas. Your next responsibility is to conduct basic maintenance of your PV and battery system. This will be covered later in this section with the slides titled Ongoing Maintenance. You are also responsible for monitoring your utility bill for major changes that could indicate a problem. This will be covered in more detail by your installer, but the basic premise will be discussed later in this section. Your next two responsibilities: conduct periodic visual inspections to address potential issues prior to a malfunction, and to conduct pre-storm inspections to address potential issues prior to a storm event, will be covered in the next section. There, you'll be walked through how to inspect your PV and battery system. The inspection process for both the periodic and pre-storm are the same, and help inform you when your PV and battery system may need to be looked at by a professional. This leads me to your next and possibly most important responsibility: to contact your contractor if issues arise, and do not attempt repairs yourself. Lastly, you are responsible for the replacement and repair costs outside of the warranty. This will be covered at the end of this section. These responsibilities will help ensure the system operates correctly and prevent system malfunctions. Possible consequences of not maintaining your system include: the system doesn't produce as much electricity as it could, meaning you have higher electricity bills; the system degrades at a higher rate; injury from loose or flying debris; an electrical fire; a severe shock injury; or ultimately, electrocution or death through shock injury. Please also remember, only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment. Next, we will list a few common installation errors. Recent hurricanes have demonstrated several PV and battery system installation errors that have been addressed in this program. These include module strength to withstand wind and flying debris, racking made of marine-grade steel that adds strength to the overall system, and bolts, fasteners, and clamps are chosen to resist high winds, are made with anti-corrosion materials, and are tightened to specifications. You'll see these issues come up again in the inspection checklist in the next section. Another common installation error was with warning labels. Each component of your PV and battery system will have an industry standard warning label sticker attached. It is important that you adhere to the warnings on these stickers and do not attempt to remove them. If stickers begin to peel or fade, contact your installer to have them replaced. For ease of access, the operating instruction should be placed near the component or system for more detailed information regarding any warning. Next, we will discuss how to safely turn your system off and on. In the event that your system needs to be powered down, such as for service, repairs, or for emergency personnel, breakers and/or the manual system disconnect can be used. Remember, only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment. Breakers are the first method to turn your system off or on. The main electrical panel controls the flow of electricity to your house. The PV system will have its own labeled breaker or breakers. These are simple switches that can be turned off or on by flipping them to the off and on sides, respectively. Be sure to cover this with your installer to avoid any confusion. The second method to turn off your PV and battery system is through a manual disconnect switch. There may be separate AC and DC disconnect switches on your system. These allow personnel to quickly stop the flow of electricity and may be used during a fire, flood, storm, or by emergency personnel. If your system is connected to the grid, you must use the disconnect to receive electricity from your PV and battery system during an outage. Be sure to check with your installer about whether your system is grid-tied or standalone, where your disconnects are, and what to do during an outage. With your system now on, we'll next discuss how to know if it is working. The first way to know if your PV and battery system is working is by looking at your electricity bill. Before interconnection of your solar PV and battery system, your utility bill will show how much electricity you use and how much you were charged for use. This is your baseline for comparison. After interconnection, your bill or separate net metering statement will also show how much electricity your system generated and by how much your bill was reduced. You can compare your pre- and post-installation charges to become familiar with the financial benefits your system is providing. Again, this will not affect your LPG bill. This amount will change based on the amount of sunlight available due to seasons, cloudiness, or other conditions, and the health of your system. Questions about your bill should be sent to your PREPA or LUMA contact. The second way to know if your system is working is by looking at your electric meter. This keeps track of the amount of electricity you use so the utility will know what to charge you. Before installation of your PV and battery system, your meter will show you your energy usage, and how fast the number changes will show how quickly you are using energy. After installation of your system, this number should increase at a slower rate or not at all, showing you that your PV and battery system is providing your electricity. Ask your installer how to best read your meter and identify possible issues. Lastly, there will be indicators on your PV and battery system components that will let you know if the system is working correctly. Your system may also have a PV monitoring system. Be sure to check with your installer about your indicators and if you have a PV monitoring system. The next slides will describe the basic maintenance that you can perform on your PV and battery system. As described before, cutting back vegetation ensures your system is generating as much electricity as it can and reduces the probability of the vegetation damaging the system during high winds. Be sure to keep any tools clear from the PV and battery system. Check with your installer if conditions are unsafe for removing vegetation. Over time, modules may become dirty due to dust, pollen, pollution, or other sources. This will reduce the electricity generated by the system. Most modules are self-cleaning given adequate precipitation. If you see a drop in electricity produced on your bill or can see the modules are fouled, you may clean the modules with plain water or a dilute mixture of water mixed with a mild dishwashing detergent. Cleaning should always be done during low light conditions, including dawn, dusk, or cloudy days. The cleaning schedule may need to be adapted to rain, pollen, bird migration, or other seasonal changes. It is recommended that roof-mounted system be cleaned by hired professionals when possible. The components of your PV and battery system will need to be replaced over time to continue to generate electricity. PV modules should last 20 to 25 years, inverters 10 to 15 years, and batteries 5 to 15 years. The lifetime of these components will vary based on their use conditions and how well they are maintained. In the CEWRI program, you will be responsible for the replacement costs when repairs fall outside of your warranty. As was mentioned earlier, the contractor that installs your PV and battery system will provide warranties for the various types of equipment. If you have questions, ask your installer about the specifics of your components and their warranties. A list of items included here are the minimums from the CEWRI program. PV modules shall have a 25-year limited warranty that modules will generate no less than 80% of their rated output under standard test conditions. PV modules that do not satisfy this warranty condition shall be replaced. Inverters and batteries have a 10-year warranty. Check with your installer about any other warranties that may apply to your components. While your current roof was assessed for this program, any future roof repairs will not be covered by your warranty. It is recommended that you hire a licensed contractor to remove and reinstall the solar PV and any water cistern systems to not invalidate your warranty. This completes this section on PV and battery system operation and maintenance. In this section, we described the responsibilities of you, the homeowner, discussed how to operate the PV and battery system at the basic level, went over the basics of system maintenance, and covered the basic ways to monitor your system and how to know if something is wrong. In the next section, we will go through the inspection checklists. In the last section, we will go through the inspection checklist to be performed periodically as well as before and after a storm. Upon completion of this section, you should be able to describe the importance of periodic and pre-storm inspections, understand how to use the periodic and pre-storm checklist before and after a storm, and identify who to call if your PV and battery system is not functioning properly. Debris can damage your PV and battery system, other property, or people during high wind events. This first part of the checklist is for homeowners to inspect the area around their system. This includes clearing sight of all debris, material, and equipment no longer in use, if possible. Otherwise, tying down or anchoring heating, ventilation, air conditioning, or HVAC, and other in-use equipment. The image depicts unsecured hardware and appliances left near a PV system. Next, cut back vegetation or tree branches that could cause damage to the system. This was covered last section in the ongoing maintenance slides. Lastly, ensure the roof drains are clear of any debris and install a roof drain cover if possible. Flooding is another major concern during a storm. Ensure your flood control and drainage systems are functioning properly and the roof penetrations are watertight. Apply outdoor rated sealant if needed. The images depict properly installed flashing. Note how the flashing goes under the higher tile to take advantage of the natural downward water flow to prevent the accumulation of water. Next, we will inspect the mechanical portions of your PV and battery system. Check the module framing to ensure structural integrity. Check the module for damage. The image shows modules that have been damaged by hail, causing cracks in the glass front layer of the module. As a precaution, take photos to capture the state of any array before an event. The fasteners and the corresponding hardware keep the modules attached to the roof. Perform a tightness check on the fasteners in the system and tighten if possible. Ask your installer how tight they should be and use a torque wrench if available. Check for any missing or corroded fasteners and replace if possible. Check all the racking hardware for corrosion, missing or damaged parts, and replace if possible. The image shows missing bolts on the racking system. Again, remove any debris from the racking hardware or system. Perform a tightness check on the racking hardware and tighten if possible. Ask your installer how tight they should be and use a torque wrench if available. Lastly, we will move on to the electrical checklist. Again, it is important to note that electrical caution should be taken for these steps and only certified personnel are allowed to install and troubleshoot renewable energy equipment. Before conducting any electrical adjustments or modifications, ensure all system AC, DC disconnects, fuses, switches, and circuit breakers are in the open or off position. Check that the junction box is securely attached to the module and is intact. The junction box is the block on the back of the module where the wires come out. The adhesive connecting the Next, check the enclosures for integrity, corrosion, and water tightness. This includes any boxes where wires feed into. Perform a tightness check on the structural mounting hardware for the boxes or enclosures and tighten if possible. Ask your installer how tight they should be and use a torque wrench if available. Check for any missing or corroded fasteners and replace if available. Check electrical connections in enclosures for corrosion, damaged or burned connections, including all bolted power connectors. Ask your installer what is safe to inspect. The image on the right, circled in red, shows a damaged inverter fuse that has burned and darkened. Check the grounding system for tightness of connections and visual continuity of the system. Ask your installer to walk you through the grounding path for your system.